back. I know the lunch is too good. That's why, you know, it's hard to get back after a good lunch. Alrighty. Now we move on to the second half of our conference. So now we have Professor Richard Self, who is the head of the analytics program from the University of Derby. So without further ado, let's welcome Richard.
Thank you very much. I wanted to look a little bit of the curriculum, which is very, very rarely included in any programs. And I want to take you through a few stories to illustrate why it is so important that we do include ethics, trust, and governance in all of our big data analytics type programs. So I want to cover a little bit about the context. I'll then want to explain in a way that we can understand how analytics, governance, trust, and ethics affect our data, the use of algorithms, big data and small data, and also some legal aspects which are going to become very, very important over the next 250 odd days, I think it is now. Anyway, middle of May next year. I want to have a quick look at how we have addressed it in the University of Derby in our curriculum. Now, one of the fundamental factors is considerable and persistent corporate and IT governance failures. If we go back over the last 10, 15 or more years, we have seen huge failures at corporate level where governance has not been applied. And we have seen almost all of my life, and I have lived through the whole of the commercial use of IT. I was born 2 years before the Leo computer was first used by Lions in London. And since the 80s onwards, we have seen that IT, although it has some successes and delivers some value, it's quite remarkably the least value-generating industry in the world. And I'll talk a bit about that as well. Now, if we look at the UK Companies Act 2006, in section 172, it talks about the responsibilities of the directors. I just want to look at two of them and use these two over the next few minutes to examine what they should be doing and what the consequences are going to be in terms of the GDPR from the European Union and other aspects of the use of IT in their business activities. So the executives have a responsibility to consider the likely consequences of any decision that they make at board directors in the long term. And I want to also consider the implications of the statement, they should also consider the desirability of the company maintaining a reputation for high standards of business conduct and so on. Yes, we also look at the interests of the company's employees, business relationships into the long term and sustainability and so on. These are all valuable things that they should be thinking about, but I want to concentrate on the long-term likely consequences of their decisions and actions and the desirability of long-term conduct. Now let's have a look at one of the starting problems with computer-related or IT-related projects. I don't know how many of you have seen the Standish Group data. Anybody? These are a set of surveys that the Standish Group, a consultancy in Massachusetts, in Boston, they put out the survey once a year to chief information officers. And this shows the tracking of successful, challenged, and failed projects. The blue line and the purple one are the successful projects, those which are defined as being on time to budget and originally delivering signed for functionality. And then after a few, in 2013, they changed the characteristics to on time to budget and delivering business value. Because the CIOs had said, well, in these days of Agile, in the old days of waterfall, long projects, how on earth could you expect the requirements not to change over a period of time? So being on the hook for delivering the functionality that was defined, say, 2, 3, 4 years ago is not fair. So let's go for adding value. Intriguingly, they then backtracked for the previous 2 years, 2012-2011, and compared the new characteristics, delivering value, with delivering the contracted for function, and discovered a drop-off in terms of the success rates. But we can see that on average we're running at 30% of IT budget projects are successful, on time to budget, delivering value or something. The red line here are the ones which failed, never got off the ground, or got off the ground and got cancelled. And these ones at the top, the sort of 40, 45, 50% are those which are on time, well, they're over budget and they don't deliver so much value. Typically 40% over budget, 40% late. So 25, maybe just 30% of all IT related budgets deliver value. All the rest waste money. They don't deliver shareholder value. The notes that you can find on the PDF version of the presentation, which will be up on my website shortly, will show the notes and some further details. It is thought that the costs of that lot and that lot could be range, and if we take account of all the failures of security and so on which we're seeing, we could be seeing costs to the world economy from all the various failures of IT are somewhere between $1 to $6 trillion. We spend $3 trillion a year on IT across the world. The world GDP is $60 trillion. So we could be wasting between 2% and about 5, 6, 7% of world GDP because of our inability to deliver IT successfully. No other industry in the world is capable of burning money that fast. Not even the banking sector with a credit crunch. So, a first issue, project success. And a couple of years ago at the IBM World Awards, Information on Demand, I forget which of the two it was, of pointing out that big data analytics projects are following exactly the same success rate, about 30%. Item number one, corporate IT governance, the question. We've seen this year some fairly spectacular problems with Uber. And that just characterizes about 4 or 5 of the major areas of problems, where there's a failure of corporate behavior, corporate governance. We see, if you go back a few years, Target, when they were discovered over a research period of big data analytics, that they could identify women who were pregnant from their spending patterns. Now, the interesting question about that there is, are there questions in big data analytics that we should not even pose to our data? Or are we free to do the analytics and then apply the ethics in terms of what we do with the answers that we get from the analytics? If you go and talk to ethicists and philosophers, you'll get many, many quick answers. I personally tend to the safer option. You should attempt to work out whether you should ask the questions rather than work out what to do once you've got the answer. Because once you've got the questions answered, Pandora's box is opened. We have another interesting problem with big data. And as we move into the world of IoT sources of data, it will get worse. About 5 years ago, John Easton from IBM drew this particular graph suggesting that by 2015, which is a couple of years ago, something like 80% of all of the data around us that we're trying to use is of uncertain veracity. Not that it's wrong, but we have no way of determining easily which data are correct and which data are incorrect and by how much. And as I think back over my own business career, it doesn't just apply to social media or to the usual sources of big data. It applies to our corporate databases as well, even those databases inside PeopleSoft and our ERP systems. Anybody who's worked in business and done a major implementation knows that as you come up to implementation day, you will look at all your master data and cleanse it. And most companies going up to implementing ERP systems will dump about 70% of all of their master data because it's 10, 20, 30 years old, it's out of date, it's irrelevant. And then they put the clean, so-called clean data into their ERP system and imagine it's going to be clean for the rest of time. I know of companies who implemented ERP systems with that level of cleansing and within 7 years realized they had to go and redo data cleansing. Because the way we now do systems since the 1980s, 1990s is we use the Pareto principle. We'll engineer only the 20% of functionality into our new system that delivers 80% of the workload. We get rid of that other 20% of the workload for efficiency reasons, which is 80% of the old functionality. Having done that, the world does not cooperate and still requires those tasks to be done. So our staff, not wishing to cause upset with the customers, will try and find ways of shoehorning those transactions through with their restricted transaction set. That inevitably causes contamination of the data. As an example, we use PeopleSoft for our HR records for the staff and all sorts of other things. And in there is a field which is supposed to identify which college or faculty I work for. Now I've worked for several over the last 12, 15 years. And I happened to notice recently that it records me in a faculty about 3 moves ago. Now, I don't care about getting it changed because it has no effect on me. It is of zero consequence to me. It doesn't affect my teaching, it doesn't affect my students, it doesn't affect assessment. I have no idea who to go to talk to get it changed. Why should I bother wasting even 10 minutes trying to track someone down to get it changed when it doesn't affect me? It might affect the central statistics group, perhaps. I don't know. Do I care? Therefore, it is in error. That's how ERP systems, these brilliant big systems that are supposed to stay clean, get contaminated. So that stuff is contaminated, I'll guarantee that, in ways which are indeterminate. And that's a whole problem. I've had students working now on location services from these things. With a bit of luck, you can get these accurate 85% within about 25 meters-ish. The worry is the data that is outside of that 25 meters, outside of that 85% of the data. I have data which is at least 1,800 kilometers in error on photos from here. And the problem is we cannot be certain when we are retail businesses and picking up data from here that you are where, that your phone is where it's claiming to be, so that you can send location-based advertising. If you're using iBeacons, you must be right, pretty certain. If you're using assisted GPS, probably it'll be right within 25 meters, so your Starbucks advert is probably going to get to the right person most of the time. But it's not very helpful if I get a Starbucks advert saying, here you are in Langkawi, in whatever this place is, and I'm actually at the other side of the island. It's not terribly helpful. It doesn't give you benefit your reputation. So we need to start thinking very much about that veracity. We have data coming from all over the place. I'm using one of those fairly regularly. I've used one of those Fitbit-y sort of things as well. Fitbits are, these health trackers are disastrous. The algorithms are unbelievably bad. They try very hard, but they don't calculate and can't even calculate steps accurately. I was talking to a colleague recently. He and his wife have the same tracker. They go running together. They apparently, they can't even get the two to agree on the distance. When I was wearing a Fitbit on my, Garmin on my right wrist and my phone either here or in my pocket, there's a 30% difference in step count. Step count, not distance, but step count. And now we have insurance companies having the temerity to use these things to sell us reductions on our insurance, health insurance, as long as we meet the targets. Well, okay, as long as it's based on that with 30% more steps, that's great. But I'm not going to do it off my tracker. But if you miss your, target, they'll charge you £12 a week in the UK. Is that ethical? No, because we are using things which are supposed to be toys for business purposes, and all of those health trackers are fundamentally unethical, and I suggest should be banned because they are so inaccurate.
Richard, did you say if you miss the target on exercise?
Yeah, if you miss,
analyzed?
Yep, there's a health insurance contract in the UK where you have paid a £12 a month, that's about $15 US a month, a week, if you don't meet your health targets that they have agreed with for you, or set for you. They are staggeringly inaccurate. They can't even measure when you're awake and asleep properly. They are toys, and that is all. And they're being used by businesses to rip us off. Social media. One of the interesting things is the fact that there are some researchers who decide the old scientific approach of having a hypothesis and then trying to prove it with some data collection and so on is unnecessary now, because with the social media, with Twitter and Facebook, you can get all the data that you need. And they say, in terms of statistics, N, the number you've got, is the whole of everything. N equals all. Yes, I can. If I can afford it, I can scrape every single tweet out of Twitter about a particular subject. So some people will say that is N equals all in statistical analysis terms. Of course it's not. That N equals all of the tweets and retweets inside Twitter is just the tweeting of a tiny proportion of the real population. Probably 0.01% or thereabouts. Might be a little bit more. So I don't have access in Twitter to all the data I need to understand social sentiment. That's part of what went wrong with the American election, part of what went wrong with the UK elections. And referendum. They didn't get at the real sentiment. They thought they had got the quick way to collect all the stuff electronically. And it only represented a small proportion. They missed out the Rust Belt in the USA. They didn't get the guys who didn't have a mobile phone, didn't have the internet. They missed out because they thought they got N equals all and they got N equals 0.5% or something. And there, all of the statistics analysis went completely wrong. we have major initiatives going on now to allow people in business access to self-service access to all the BI. How are we being certain that the data that is actually going to be used is meaningful? We've got the veracity problem, we've got the fact that people aren't necessarily really careful about joining data together. How do we know that they're going to end up with the right sort of answers? What are our processes in the business to make sure that we're helping people put things together correctly? And then in law terms, General Data Protection Regulation from the European Union. It affects every country in the world because it affects European Union citizens. And so every business in the world is now subject to the European GDPR because you may have data relating to an EU citizen. And some of the interesting points that are made by the GDPR documentation is the distinctive aspects of big data. The use of algorithms of a wide range of powers, the fact that often the processing is extremely difficult to understand. We tend to collect as much data as we can and then repurpose it, and we keep acquiring new data about people. We're terribly, terribly interested in big data, and yet we forget the power and the importance of small data to actually understand why. Big data is statistics, it's the how, the what, and the where, and the when. But if you want to understand what's going on, you need the little data, the small data. That's what made House of Cards so spectacularly successful, because although Alpha House, which probably nobody's heard of, and House of Cards were created initially in the same sort of way by Amazon and by Netflix, the difference after all of the activity of analyzing the preliminary data, they went with the machine answer. Netflix then took all the machine data and advice and analysis and then applied their own human intuition, understanding, experience about how things work.
I can't go through all the other ones. You'll need to look at some of my presentations to commercial organizations or commercial conferences to explain a bit more of this where I have more time.
So to look at the curriculum, first of all, one of the things we do in Derby is we're all at undergraduate and at master's level, we bring in the Data for Humanities principles. The reasoning being to bring people, or of the principles, is to bring people and institutions together who share the motivation to use data for common good and human well-being. And the principles are this. How many of you have seen the Data for Humanity principles? I've shared them last year, I think, with the attendees of the conference or the year before. These come out of Frankfurt University by Professor Roberto Zicari and Andreas Ritter. And these are the five principles, which we think are really, really important. The link is in the notes. And I get the students to embed these into the type of data that they select as part of their projects. We have a couple of programs, and we, in these three modules here and these modules, the Data for Humanity principles and ethics, trust, governance are fundamentally built into all of these areas. So IT Services Management module, we're looking at the problems of project failure to avoid that huge waste of money that IT causes. We very much in Sustainable Information Corporate Governance, a final year module, go through all of the stuff. And then in the Enterprise Systems and Information Security Assurance modules, which are alternatives, again, as a capstone module, but not a project, they need to be able to take account of ethics and trust and governance aspects and security. We build the same stuff into visualization because visualization is very, very easy to tell lies very, very quickly. false origins, changing the scales from linear to log-log, totally changes the perspective, and you can tell some beautiful lies while telling the truth. And so we're trying to get a feeling of ethics into that. We do those the same path. So just a brief, as Michelle pointed out, in all of the assignments that I set here across the various modules I teach, they're always big open questions. And the students always, in all of these assessments, have to choose a small area of the project or of the topic in which to work. So they can make that big project or big topic their own by selecting a bit there or a bit there. And you can see here, these are the actual titles of the project. So they've got to work out what sort of IoT data am I going to use there. And so they then go to research what are IoT, what is IoT, what sources and so on, and they come up with a new IoT service. Here, no organizations that I have come across yet have really got to get grips with what happens when we can't trust our data completely, that we're pouring through analytics of some sort to try and make business decisions. They're not really focusing on the fact that these crystal balls don't exist properly. They've forgotten about star diagrams from statistics and financial analysis 30 years ago, and they're just taking predictive analytics as this is the answer for next year or next 5 years. Rubbish. It's just one little wavy line amongst many wavy lines. And they aren't really getting to grips with understanding what it means. So a retailer, does it matter if I've got 1 in 1,000 adverts go 500 miles adrift? And probably not. What happens if it's 5%, if it's 10%? What happens if 30% are in the wrong place, the wrong shopping mall? How do they, should they be thinking about characterizing those levels of error before they start doing executive stuff? And so on. And then we do it into our masters. We actually have we are the only master's program, I think, with an analytics, ethics, trust and governance module there, which we've just run for the first time this year, quite successfully. It means that our programs are almost unique in terms of ethics, trust and governance are in all three of our programs. And they're also in other programs, but which aren't analytics based. There are a whole lot of appendices that there's specific examples, and then there's the 12 V's of big data as well at the end in the appendices. But they'll be up on my university profile and LinkedIn profile quite shortly as a full PDF. Thank you.
Richard, question. I was just curious, have you come across a book by Kitsa? His last name is Kitsa.
No.
He writes extensively on ethics and morals in cyber.
Oh, right, I have to track that one down, thank you.
Okay, great. Right, let's thank Richard again with a big hand.